Miriam Meets on RTE Radio 1 with Miriam O'Callaghan.
Hello there. Gabriel Byrne is what you'd call a real star. He's an Irish actor who has achieved professional success and recognition here in his native Dublin, in London, in Hollywood and in New York, where he now lives. Teri Hayden has been his agent since the early days of his career. Gabriel was her first client, and together they learned the ropes of the international world of film and theatre. Teri now runs her own very successful company, The Agency, from offices here in Dublin. Teri and Gabriel were friends long before they were professionally associated, and both the friendship and the professional relationship have lasted more than 30 years. And you're both very welcome here this morning.
Thanks, Mary. Thank
you. Okay, Teri, so how did you meet in Dublin, and when did you meet? Go on, she's laughing already.
Okay. Well, I suppose when did we meet? Áine O'Connor was my very good friend and Gabriel was a boyfriend. And when they started going out together, Áine called me one night to go and see a play in Dunleary in the Pavilion Theatre. This was a play that was co-written by Manix Flynn and Peter Sheridan. And Gabriel and a lot of the well-known Irish actors were putting on this production in the Pavilion. So the play was called The Liberty Suit, and it was quite an introduction for me to go and see such a radical play and to see all these young actors naked on the stage.
Were they all naked?
Yes, yes. And it was just, it was a wonderful evening, and we went for a drink afterwards in the Elfin Bar. It is Áine, introduced me to her the love of her life.
Do you remember that night, Gabriel?
I do. I remember it very well, actually. I think only myself and Manix were naked, actually. And looking back on it, there was absolutely no reason for us to be naked, except we were too stupid at the time to question why we were. But yeah, I remember that night very clearly. We kind of hit it off immediately because Teri was one of Áine's, well, her closest friend, really. And she had been wanting me to meet her for quite a long time. So she came down with her husband from, where did you live at that time?
Clarinda Park.
Up in Dunleary. Yeah, and I didn't think at that time that we were going to have any kind of professional relationship. We just kind of really got on well together.
And I mean, for people who don't remember, and most people will, I mean, Áine O'Connor was a massive star in Ireland. She was a big, huge TV presenter. How did you meet her, Teri, originally?
I had a flat in Dublin. I was working in RTE, and I had just moved into this flat, and two other women, I scarcely knew them, but they needed a fourth person. So they put an ad in the paper, and Áine was the successful applicant. She stayed for a week, but when she was given a rota of duties that were her duties to do, she looked at me and said, "Let's get the hell out of here." So we did. We moved out. We moved into a flat in Duke Street, just opposite the Bailey Pub. That wasn't a great idea if you wanted to sleep at night. And we just became firm friends. And she was an O'Connor and I'm an O'Connor. And as I say, I was working in RTE, and Áine had been working for a magazine that had just folded. And one night, Rita Foran, who was in charge of the PAs at the time, was looking for someone to come in on a temporary basis. And I thought, well, Áine would be the perfect person. So she came in to do a bit of temporary work and stayed.
That's amazing how things begin. Yeah. How did you meet Áine first, Gabriel?
Well, I was doing a play at the at the Focus Theatre. And Áine was this very tall, beautiful, charismatic woman. And I remember in the Focus, being such a tiny theatre, the word spread backstage like wildfire that Áine O'Connor was in the audience. And we thought that she was there perhaps, and it might result in a mention of the play, which was A Month in the Country by Turgenev, in which Joan Bergen played my love interest, and I was her love interest, and she spurned me at the end.
Oh, no.
Never forgave her for that. Afterwards, we went down to Hurricane's pub, and Áine and I instantly clicked. It's what the French call, I think, a coup de foudre, where you just look at the other person and they look at you, and it's instantaneous. So she came to the wrap party for the production, which was three nights later, and she brought a boyfriend with her. And I always remember she said to him, "I bet you couldn't drink 3 gins, 3 vodkas and a brandy," which he said, "Of course I could." And he did, collapsed on the couch and she left with me.
I'm naughty of her.
Naughty, but...
And that was the beginning.
That was the beginning, yeah.
Yeah, but were they great days in Dublin, Teri? Like when you were all friends at that stage?
It was very exciting. I mean, there was great theatre going on. I mean, if you think of the Project Arts Theatre in those days and you think of the actors who have come from the project who are now well known. I mean, if you think of Liam Neeson and Kieran Hines and Stephen Ray and Gabriel, all these people who were, there was just fairly radical theatre going on. But having said that, I worked in RTE, you know, when was it 1969, 1970? And I did think in those days, having come from the north, that it was quite a strange and sexist institution to work in. I mean, the marriage ban was something that I couldn't fathom this, that women had to retire when they got married, which had all sorts of consequences.
Sounds so bizarre.
It does.
It
sounds
like hard to believe. I remember you telling me once about that you got a letter from one of the higher-ups
telling me to lower my skirt, you know, because it was the mini skirt in here.
That's so funny.
And you couldn't wear trousers.
And you couldn't really wear trousers unless you're on an OB, on an outside broadcast. So, you know, there was a bit of a dilemma here as to what to wear.
That is hilarious.
But then I think you started, wasn't that beginning of how you started making clothes?
Yeah, it's my little hobby. I went out and bought a little sewing machine, you know, one of these. I think it was 10 bob, you know, to sort of try and learn to make suitable clothes.
Well, it wasn't really appropriate to wear.
It would be appropriate to wear. And then, of course, I had got married at that stage, and I found myself a year into RTE pregnant, trying to figure out what you wear when you're pregnant if you can't wear a mini skirt or trousers.
Typical.
And, you know, it was a tricky one, but it got me sewing, which was good.
But I mean, I suppose to go full circle with Áine, she was incredibly important in both of your lives. And I know tragically we'll talk about it. She did die. But I mean, it's well known you taught, didn't you, Gabriel? You were a teacher at the time. I mean, spell it out. If she hadn't taken an interest in your career, do you think you would have ever become an actor full time and given up the teaching?
Unlikely. I think that it's a wonderful thing to be able to point in your life to people who have made a decisive difference. Somebody who comes in and doesn't share your own fears about the future and recognises the dreams or the ambitions that sometimes latently might be there and encourages you. In other words, somebody who has faith in you. Even when you don't have faith yourself. I remember when we went to London first, which was a big deal to leave the security of Dublin and to head to London, where essentially I was unemployed for 18 months. And I finally got a job. And Áine went down to Camden to buy luggage because we had left Ireland with plastic bags. And she bought these 3 huge silver cases. And I asked her how much she'd spent on them. And she said, 80 quid. And I said, we don't have 80 quid. And so we had this big row about the cases and the money. What it actually was an act of faith in the future. Mm-hmm. It was saying that you will be traveling and you will need cases. And it was so typical of her extravagance and her sense of belief, because there were so many people that she helped. I remember one night she said to me, we have to go down to this club at 12 o'clock. I said, oh, no, really? Anyway, we went down. She said, this guy is really talented. We got to see him. And it was Dermot Morgan.
Wow.
And I also remember that when Horselips, when she was presenting a program called, I think it was Summer House with Tom McGourke, she insisted on this band that she said were really talented coming onto the show. And there was resistance to the band because they were electrifying the sacred, you know, traditional Irish music. And it was Horselips. And many more people that she encouraged. And I learned so much from her unselfish encouragement that now when I see a kid, 16, 17, 20, who says, well, I don't really know what I want to do, I always say to them, well, if you could wave a wand, what would you like to do? And then encourage them to go do that, because the importance of a mentor or somebody who encourages you, you cannot underestimate that.
And yet it was Teri, when you didn't have an agent at the beginning, when you were just about to go very big, Gabriel, you sent Teri in, who wasn't an agent at all, to negotiate on your behalf, was it, instead of Anya? Or okay, go on, Teri.
I had moved to McGill magazine. I was working there.
With Vincent.
And obviously I had had great interest in acting and actors and theatre and film. And Gabriel had just had this thing in his head that I was a negotiator, and he wanted me to, he just asked me, would I consider opening up an agency? He felt there was a gap in the market for an agent, and this was a completely foreign concept to me. I didn't really know what an agent did. And, you know, he's quite determined when he wants. He kept pushing me on it and saying, you know, really, this is something you could do. There is nobody in Ireland doing this, and I think you could do this. And I said, well, what do I do? And he said, well, it's simple. I have an offer of work, and the casting director is this person. You call her and ask what the offer is. And then you say, double it.
That's good advice.
Which he's been saying to me ever since.
And did he do that?
Well, not quite like that. I mean, I didn't want to sound so naive. I had a lot to learn. And I think what I did at the beginning was, and looking back, I remember when the Irish RM started in Dublin, I went in for that casting session and the producers were there. And I did declare myself. I said, I really have no experience of this. I'm completely new to it. Can somebody explain to me how residuals work, how buyouts work? And I found it's a good way to be in this business, because I think people do sometimes pretend they know more than they do. Yeah. And people who do know are delighted to tell you. So I started that way. But with Gabriel, it was quite easy because, you know, he was there encouraging me all of the time.
And what was it you spotted in her? I mean, in other words, you'd spoken earlier there about how Anya was very important in helping you to believe in you. But obviously you believed, you saw something in Teri that she could be this agent.
I did, yeah. I think it's a quality that is very much part of who she is, which is she has a certain fearlessness. And
she's a northerner
and a belief in herself, an instinctively good business person. And I understood that really there's only a certain amount that you have to know, and then the rest of it is up to you. And I believed she could do it. It was her intelligence and her integrity, and the fact that I could trust her. Mm. And these are things that you cannot pay for.
Yeah. And also, maybe because you came from Derry, and your dad was a businessman, and you had six brothers as well. Do you think that background maybe gave you this business acumen?
I definitely think so. I think having six brothers makes you very competitive. And I grew up that with that fighting spirit. I mean, you fought or died in my house. So I was sent off to boarding school at 10 or 11, really to try and make me a more rounded person and to meet women and girls, you know. But my father was a great influence on me, on my life. There's no doubt about it. He was involved in a tea blending business, but his main focus was they imported wine and spirits. He took over a company as a managing director that was not doing so well at all and turned it into a very, very successful company and became a very successful businessman. And he came from Castledara, County Tyrone. He had a fairly humble background, but very educated. Mm. And he did instill in me a great sense of... his motto was, my word is my bond. And even though, you know, there would have been the Catholic-Protestant divide very much so in Derry, I think if you were in business, it didn't seem to impinge so much. I mean, it didn't matter to my father, really, who he was. You know, everybody was the same. Mm. Everybody was equal. And he was a decent man. So he did have a great influence on me.
Actually, decent is a much undervalued word, I think. Yeah. You know, that decency obviously stuck with you as well.
Yeah.
Anya tragically died, of course. Was it in 98? About 98,
yes.
I think. Mm. Yeah. And would the closeness you'd all formed together Was that a bond that you shared then to face her death together?
Absolutely. Gabriel was in America when Anya was ill. Anya really didn't tell people she was ill. I think I was probably the only person who knew she was so ill, even up until about a month before she died. And she, even Anya denied it. But it was very tough for Gabriel because he was working abroad and I was, you know, just keeping him informed on a limited basis because, you know, who knows? I mean, when it happened in the end, we were all so surprised it happened so quickly. But it did bond. It certainly was a bond, even for the kids. You know, my children would have known Anya all their lives, and she was great with young people, great at helping them to, you know, encouraging them, giving them confidence.
Did you find that a difficult time?
Yes, it was tremendously difficult because we'd been in a relationship for quite a long time, and then we had parted, and we had remained after a difficult period of adjustment. We had become friends again, and perhaps more intimate in a way because of just pushing into this new emotional kind of threshold. But I spoke to her the morning that that she died, and she called me from hospital, and she had bought a dress for the premiere of this film that we were going to do at the Savoy with Leonardo DiCaprio, and a film that I had made with him. And she talked about me coming in that week, and she could barely speak on the phone, and I knew that was... I didn't think that she would die that day, but I knew it was imminent. And yes, it did cement the relationship with the people who knew her. Mm-hmm. And we all, I think we were all bereft because she was such a huge influence in all our lives.
That brings us to our first piece of music, Teri, which is, I suppose, loving the moment, enjoying what you have, which is a Madeleine Peru song.
Yeah, This Is Heaven. I love this song. I think it would probably be the way I feel about life. Be happy with what you have.
When I hear them say there's better living, let them go their way to that new living. I won't ever stray, 'cause this is heaven to me.
That was your choice there, Teri. Madeleine Peru, beautiful song. The interesting thing is, Gabriel, apart from the obvious reason that women like you, but you often say you like the company of women, sometimes more than men.
I have a lot of women friends, yeah. And I think I tend to gravitate more towards women. I don't really know why. I have many male friends, obviously. But I think that you can go to levels of intimacy, emotional intimacy with women much easier than you can with men. I think men are sometimes confined by the role that the culture imposes on them and what's acceptable and not acceptable to share. And I do like to discuss the ins and outs of the complexities of...
like Dr. Paul. Oh. No, not that complex.
I remember there was a guy in Dublin who earned, he had a reputation, you know who this bloke was, but I won't mention his name, but he used to brag in pubs that he understood the tangled web of women's emotions. I won't say that's the way I see it, but...
Well, Gabe was always interested in the nitty-gritty, you know, I mean, we're a lot of...
Did he like gossip?
He loves gossip. I mean, he wants to go to the nth detail and long conversations on the phone. But that's what makes him, you know, so wonderful with women. It's unusual because most men, if you're trying to tell them a story about a piece of gossip, are listening with one ear, whereas Gabriel actually wants to know it all and will recount it. Then he'll embellish it and tell it again.
From your point of view, I suppose, he's known, and you're both obviously very attractive. You're sitting in front of me. But did you ever fancy him?
did I ever fancy him. When the first time I saw him on stage, I thought he was electrifying and amazing, but we never had that.
He was naked then, though.
That's true. This is true. This is a question we've been asked many times, and we've had to actually go on the record about this. We've always liked each other as friends and professionally, but we've never been involved in any way.
And yeah, there was one newspaper in Dublin that reported, we had gone out for dinner one night. And
we hadn't seen each other in quite a long time, and we had gone out for dinner. And
this reporter made this allegation that we were in the restaurant and that we were actually holding hands, which
cuddling
made me laugh anyway,
because
I can't imagine myself ever holding Terry's hand or Terry allowing me to hold her.
Or sitting in a restaurant cuddling.
That made me laugh. Yeah. And then I said, no, but this is actually bullshit and it's a lie and we can't let them get away with this. So we had a discussion about it and I said, sue them.
We sued them.
Did you?
Yeah, I did.
I didn't even know that.
Well, I was, I mean, we were both, I mean, at first I laughed because it was so ludicrous. And secondly, then I thought, well, no, actually, this isn't, you know, I'm a businesswoman. I'm married very happily.
Yeah,
Gabriel has his life, his relationships. It's something that has been inferred over the years, but it isn't true, which I suppose is what makes our relationship so unique, that we've actually known each other for, you know, the best part of 40 years, that we like each other enormously. We're the best of friends. We work together.
Do you ever fight?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. The truth is we wouldn't last a day as a couple.
No.
But as friends, we can weather all kinds of storms. And yes, we've had, many standoffs, as is inevitable in any friendship. But it's one of the things I'm really, really proud of in my life is that I have maintained a very close, intimate relationship with Terry, and also a business relationship. Mm. And I've watched Terry go from being a tentative businesswoman in Dublin, as she was explaining, not really understanding the complexities of the business, to being, without contradiction, one of the best agents in the world.
That's amazing.
And that's knowing for many years, the ins and outs and the ups and downs of Hollywood agents. And I would say, without fear of argument, that she is in one of the top agents in the world.
Because obviously you've got a huge stable of actors now. From Gabriel at the beginning, it's gone mega, as they say.
Yeah.
But from your point of view, everyone knows, I suppose, Gabriel's successes, his big films. What's been the sweetest moment for you? I mean, was there one moment that you enjoyed the most as his agent?
You know, it's hard to pick out one moment, because for someone like Gabriel to have sustained a career over, you know, 35 years on the international market is incredible. I mean, the breadth of work that Gabriel has covered is remarkable. In fact, the last film that he's just completed, a film with Charlotte Rampling, which, you know, going from huge budget films to very small indie production. Mm. We just heard that it had been chosen for the special gala performance at Toronto. And
wow.
This was a film that was made for $1 million, you know, as opposed to some of the films which would be 30 or 40 million. But, I mean, certainly when you're in New York and Gabriel's nominated for a Tony Award, or he wins a Golden Globe Award or an Emmy, you know, it's those moments are the rewarding moments. The rest of it is the day to day. Will we do this? You know, should we look at this, getting the scripts read? And then the fun part of it also would be the travel. We do travel quite a lot together.
Moon for the Misbegotten, though, how important was that play to you? The Eugene O'Neill one.
Well, I had begun my career on the stage, like every actor of my time. And Eugene O'Neill is a tremendously difficult playwright to do. But that play, Moon for the Misbegotten, is one of the most moving pieces of theatre I think I've ever encountered. It was an extremely difficult role, and I would regard it as one of the highlights of my career. I think that sometimes people have a superficial view of what it is that actors actually do. Sometimes I think that the acting is the easy part of it. how you take care of yourself when you're not working, when you're not on a schedule, is equally important. Because the business is fraught with insecurity. Because once a job finishes, you've no guarantee that you'll ever get another job again. And that seems to be part of the psyche of most actors, no matter how successful they are, this gremlin of insecurity of where is the next job going to come from. But I think that you have to be able to deal with rejection. You have to be able to deal with criticism. And in the beginning, when rejection and criticism sting and hurt, but when you expose yourself in that way to criticism, you have to go through a necessary period of it hurting. And then you have to come out the other side and learn to accept that criticism is very much part of what we do and rejection is part of it. And you cannot appeal to all people at all times and you cannot do this business to be loved and to be approved of. You have to do it for yourself and for what you see as the vocation of it.
Which doesn't mean it's easy.
No, it's not easy at all. It's a tremendously difficult job, as Teri will tell you, because she works on the front line with actors, you know, day and night and has a real understanding of that part of it.
I mean, and you spoke also about it, like it's not make-believe, it's kind of finding the truth in yourself when you do roles. What do you mean by that?
Well, I remember once I did a film and there was a girl who worked on the film who used to do this little beaded jewellery. And one day I passed her and I said, wow, that's really great. And at the wrap party, she came in, she presented me with a little bracelet that she had made herself. And I was really touched and moved by it. And she said, no, do you really like it? I said, I love it. I think it's, and the fact that you made it for me is even makes it even more special. And the director was standing there with a few drinks on him and he said, oh, well, he would say that, wouldn't he? And I said, what do you mean? And he said, well, he's an actor. His job is to lie. And I don't know where the answer came from, but there wasn't a second of thought about it. And I turned to him and I said, you don't understand anything about acting. An actor's job is to tell the truth. That's what acting is. It's about finding a truth. And people who think that they don't act in life are mistaken because most of us act all the time in one role or another.
So true. And actually, we're talking about bad reviews there, but when you did that play, Moon for the Misbegotten, Ben Brankley, who is like the god who can make or break you, he actually said, I'm just quoting one line, he said, Mr. Byrne's long third act monologue is a harrowing act of self-administered surgery etched in escalating degrees of pain. It is, in a word, brilliant. Itself the stuff of theatrical legend. Now, many people would adore that and sail on the next night, but I read that you actually almost found that as difficult as a bad review because you had to get up the next night and almost reach the same standard.
The thing about the theatre is that what you did the night before doesn't matter because the audience wasn't there the night before. They're here tonight. And so each time you stand in the wings you're overcome with nerves and fear and you have to push through that and walk out onto the stage, it's irrelevant what they say. Of course, it's a torture. If he had said, Mr. Byrne's performance is so bad that you shouldn't go to this, you'd still have to get out the next night and still do it again.
Do you find yourself, Teri, sometimes, as well as an agent, do you have to help him sometimes whenever he would have got maybe bad things said? Are you a bit like a Dr. Paul to him sometimes?
We certainly talk about all aspects of it. I mean, there would be, you know, there's so many areas around taking the job. I mean, you can be working on a production where perhaps the film itself, the script itself is terrific, but in fact, all the elements around it are maybe not as they should be. And then you find yourself battling, you know, all sorts of incidentals. So nobody would even know that all that element exists.
But you did Camelot recently, which is like comedy.
It's not really comedy. I'd worked with Richard Burton and then I'd worked with Richard Harris, who had both played the role of King Arthur. And they both had said to me at separate times, if you ever get a chance to do this, you should. They'd forgotten to inquire whether I could actually sing or
I
not.
I think this was the bravest thing that Gabriel ever did.
I think it may have been up there with moments where you think, I wish an earthquake would happen now and we wouldn't have to go on. But I remember coming up to the Lincoln Center and I saw all these OB trucks outside, broadcast unit trucks outside. And I said to the driver, oh, they must be doing something here. And he said, oh, no, that's for your show. The opening night was going live across America. And we had only rehearsed with the orchestra once, which was the New York Philharmonic, probably the greatest orchestra in the world. 100-piece orchestra, and I cannot sing. So I remember the musical director, a man called Paul G. Magnani, who's worked on all the great Broadway musicals, he said to me, Mr. Byrne, you're getting really good at backbeat. I said, thanks very much. He said, it's something you don't want to be getting good at. I said, what does it mean? He said, well, it means when the orchestra's at that speed, you're behind them, and when you're behind them, we're in front. So we have to kind of keep in... And the most nerve-wracking thing was, it's one thing doing Eugene O'Neill or Shakespeare or whatever, but counting that four in your head and waiting for the orchestra to come in behind you was absolutely terrifying. And I lost my nerve on two nights and came in at 1-2. I just couldn't stand the tension of it anymore. And they had to swing in behind me. But... yeah, it went live, and I sang, or sang, I should say, the role that Richard Burton and Richard Harris had both beautifully essayed. But yeah, it was absolutely nerve-wracking.
Did you enjoy it?
I enjoyed it in retrospect, but I was glad that I had done it.
But he was terrific. Mm. I was there in the audience. It was really a wonderful night.
It had a sentimental... thing for me, because the first record that I remember ever getting was a copy of the musical. Yeah. And it was one of those old things where you had to drop the little needle onto it. And, yeah. You know, so.
And for that reason, we're going to listen now to Richard Harris singing How to Handle a Woman.
How to handle a woman. There's a way, said the wise old man. A way known to every woman since the whole rigmarole began. Do I flatter her? I begged him answer. Do I threaten or cajole or plead?
Richard Harris are singing How to Handle a Woman. You've known each other for so long in your lives, like over 40 years. Obviously, you've had a lot of fame, Gabriel. Has he changed? Have either of you changed a lot? And if so, how over the 40 years?
I don't think Gabriel has changed that much. I think we've both mellowed a bit, as one does, as one gets older. I don't think we have quite as tempestuous a work relationship now as we used to have. Or we maybe have learned the skills to navigate our way through life a little bit better. But essentially, Gabriel is the same. He's a Dublin man who made his career in America. I think the most interesting part of all of that is that Gabriel, I think, was probably one of the first or the first to actually go from Dublin to, well, first of all, to London and then to America and make a career out of that. Today, it happens in maybe in a slightly different way where the young actors would possibly, their career trajectory would be a film that's possibly made here in London and then would get attention in the States, and thus the actor hopefully makes his career that way internationally. So, you know, Gabriel is the same. He's the same Dublin man that I met all of those years ago. Still the same sense of humour, still the great fun. And I think the fact that he has never lost a sense of his roots as well, that he's come back every year and brought the children back as much as possible when they were younger, he's just retained his identity 100%.
Do you like Ireland as much as ever?
Well, that's a kind of complex question, really. I'm fascinated by the country. I've never lost interest in it. I read the Irish papers every day. I consider myself to be an Irishman who works in America. My children are American, but they also have roots here. Following the story, the narrative of Ireland from another perspective is very interesting. And observing how the country has changed since I left it is something that I could not do without. I'm as interested in the unfolding events in Ireland today as I was, you know, 40 years ago, probably more so.
Mm. And from your perspective, I suppose everybody's life has ups and downs. Because you became so famous, they were often lived on a public stage. Do you find that easier to deal with as you get older?
I think you come to accept whatever notoriety one has been part of one's life. I subscribe to the belief that fame doesn't essentially change who you are, but it certainly changes people around you. And that can be unsettling for somebody who is insecure, shy, doesn't understand where exactly life has taken them. You know, the difference between, I think, when I was starting was that fame was an obscure space station. Nobody ever thought one could get there. Now it's a career choice among young kids who think that they can just become, well, I don't want to be a doctor or a librarian, I want to be famous.
You nearly need to go and learn how to deal with fame, because actors don't know how to deal with fame. It's not something you learn, it's something that happens, and you learn as you go along, and some people just don't make it.
People can be unhinged by sudden success because it's a complete... what's the word?
Readjustment
towards other people's perspective of you. I remember one Saturday night years ago, I was completely unknown. And on the Monday morning, a woman crashed her car into a lamppost looking back to see, was it me? And suddenly the entire country knew who I was.
That Bracken. Weird.
Yeah. And that was... unsettling for a while because I was still myself. But
what was the story you were telling me about Brendan and you talking about people stopping you in the street? It's a funny story.
Brendan Gleeson. Yeah.
I think this is a Brendan Gleeson one where somebody comes up and says, are you Brendan Gleeson? No. And I go, come on, you're Brendan Gleeson. No, I'm not Brendan Gleeson. And now, come on, you're Brendan Gleeson. We all know you're Brendan. Yeah, I am. No, you're not.
That's actually so good and so believable.
Yeah.
But you're an interesting mix because I've never met you before, actually. But what's interesting about you, I always think, is, you know, you appear slightly tortured, albeit incredibly creative. And yet you're very honest about things like being depressed in the past or drinking too much. And that can be very important for other people.
This is something that we discussed, Teri and I, because when you speak out about your personal battles or journey, you speak out not so much for yourself, but for the person who might be afraid to speak out or might be ashamed to speak out. And that's really why I did it. I didn't find it cathartic in any way. And I'm somewhat ambivalent about it because you speak out about it once and you want to park the subject. But I'm now very wary of doing interviews because inevitably the same questions come up and it looks as if I'm talking about the same thing all the time. I think that those struggles that I have had, that I continue to have, are struggles that I think that many people would identify and share with, have shared with me about their own particular issues. I don't want to become a poster boy for any of those issues. I just happen to say this is the way I felt. It requires a great deal of honesty with oneself to push through these issues into some other version of yourself. I regard myself as being stronger and more empathetic because of these struggles.
I think it's a really good thing he did it. He obviously said he spoke to you about it.
All of those areas of Gabriel's life and my life, we have dealt with them together. You don't live a life without illness and marriage breakdowns and death and births and all those, the ups and downs. But I don't think there's been any occasion in our adult lives that that any of these serious things haven't been discussed in detail and decisions made together. That's why I suppose that's why we're here together as friends today, is that we are those good friends. We've been there for all of those occasions.
And now, of course, you're the cultural ambassador. And in a sense, being a poster boy for that is very good because there's so much good work has been done in the States.
Yeah, I regarded it as an extension of what I'd been doing anyway. But the previous government decided to make it official. I mean, I would emphasise it's a non-political appointment. It's also a non-paying appointment.
Could it be the road to the presidency here? We're looking for
No, I'm going to leave that up to you, Miriam.
I tried to persuade. I thought he would be a marvellous president.
Oh, go on, announce it now.
It's an honour to have been appointed to that position. And I think that the work that Culture Ireland does in America is amazing. They pave the way for Irish artists to come to America, and Culture Ireland opens doors for them. Mm-hmm. And part of my remit is to be is to work in tandem, because Americans tend to have a very one-dimensional view of Irish art, and we're trying to make them more aware that there's more to Irish art than The Quiet Man and U2. Not that I am in any way comparing those two, but that's
something so well known, or River Dance or something.
Yeah, yes, exactly.
But it takes up a lot of your time, doesn't it?
It does take up a lot of time, and I spent the last year and a half curating a retrospective of Irish film at the Museum of Modern Art, which examined Irish film from 1910 to 2010, and what it says about us and how people perceive us led to very, very interesting after discussions of the films. And I worked with the Archaeological Institute of America to feature Ireland this year as their country. So all those things have been tremendously satisfying, but they take up a huge amount of time.
And obviously another thing that's taking up a lot of his time and your time is At Swim Two Birds. You're finally going to be able to make it, we hope.
We hope. This is a project that Brendan Gleeson, John Borman and myself have been working on for several years now in conjunction with Parallel. With Alan Maloney. Brendan has written the screenplay, and we are almost there in terms of financing. And Gabriel will be playing the Pooka in It Swim Two Birds, and we have a great cast. You know, a lot of actors who've committed to this over the years, Colin Farrell, Michael Fassbender, Cillian Murphy.
A roll call of Irish.
Mm-hmm.
Great actors. Are you looking forward to it, Gabriel, if it happens?
I am looking forward to it very much because it'll be the first picture I've done here in many, many years. And to work with such a gallery of incredible actors. We did a read-through a few years ago, about a year ago, in a hotel in Dublin. And to see that cross-generation of older actors and younger actors, all really nervous sitting around the table of each other, was very touching. And I think that we're all behind Brendan because I think he's written a fantastic adaptation. Yeah, it'll be a thrill to work with all those young guys.
So the plan is to go springtime 2012.
Let's hope that does really happen. Mm-hmm. It would be great. And we're going to end in a piece of music by your son, actually, because he's in his group. I think it's sweet because he's called Jack Daniel.
Mm-hmm.
And your daughter's called Romy Marion.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking, is Marion called after your sister who died?
Yes, Marion, my sister who died tragically at 33. And my daughter is called Marion. Romy Marion, called after Romy Schneider, the German actress, and my sister Marion. Fortunately, my son has gone into a branch of the business that has nothing to do with acting. He's a musician and a very great musician. And my daughter called me into her room about a year ago for a conversation that she wanted to have with me. And she said, "Dad, we have something to discuss." And I thought, oh God, what could this be? Pregnant, getting married. Worse, she wants to become an actress.
Aww.
So I said, absolutely, I support you 100%. I think she'll be really terrific because she's beautiful and she's deep and she's sensitive. She's amazing, really, isn't she?
Ellen Bark and Gabriel Byrne's daughter. Yeah. You
can't go wrong. Can't go wrong with that combination. So the piece of music we're going to end on is your son playing in this group. Tell me about it, the Dough Rollers.
Yes, they just opened for Bob Dylan in America.
Pretty good.
Which, you know, 21 years of age, that's some achievement. I asked him what Dylan said to them. And he said he didn't say much, but on the last night he came into the dressing room and he said, "Just keep doing what you're doing." They're very traditional and very purist in what they play. So they tend to play unadulterated blues. And I found myself in the unique position of trying to get into one of his concerts and not having a ticket and having to buy a scalper's ticket for twice the price.
That's hilarious, $50, actually. Yeah. And he plays what on this? He plays the guitar?
He plays guitar and he does backup vocals. He also plays the piano and mouth organ and multi-instruments.
The one we're going to listen to is The Chosen One Blues. It's for me to thank you, Teri. You said you'd be nervous at the beginning. You weren't a bit nervous. Thank you for being my guest today. Gabriel, thank you very much.
Thank you,
success
Mary.
To both of you going forward, and I hope you remain friends for the next 40 years.
Yes. And
my thanks to my producer, Eileen Heron, and sound to Richard McCulloch. I'll be here at the same time next Sunday. Thank you very much for listening. And we're going out listening to Gabriel's son in the Dough Rollers with The Chosen One Blues.
Miriam meets on RTE Radio 1 with Miriam O'Callaghan.